We are so excited to have you attend the Mayor's Cabinet in the Community. I wanted to start our program off by saying thank you so much to our host event location, which is right here at Henry World Legacy School. Let's give them a round of applause. It is absolutely wonderful to be here in this school. We're excited to be here. We have a lot going on for you this morning. We have a job fair for you this morning that I'm really excited about and hope you take advantage of that. But without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and introduce to you our entertainment for this morning. We're really excited to have these students right here in front of us. We're excited to hear them perform for the mayor and for you. So without further ado, let me introduce to you Miss West, our teacher. Yes, and we have the Eagle Ensemble, Eagle Harmony Ensemble, singing two songs for us. Ready? Give them a warm welcome.
Just as someday,
Great job, guys. Great job. I understand that Kiana has a birthday today. Is that right? Let's give Kiana a happy birthday. Good job. Wonderful. Wonderful. Well, now that we've had our entertainment, they did a great job. They did that first song in Swahili. Wasn't it beautiful? And the second one in Cherokee. So beautiful, beautiful job for our students. Next, what I want to say to you, we are very grateful for all the hands that it takes to put this on. A special thanks to Jessica Kudo and Roz. Is this me? A special thank you to Roz Alston and to Derek Kubo and the entire HRCP team who helps put this on, to our Denver Public Library who prints all of our flyers and brochures. Thank you so much. To our facility teams and to all the rest of you who make this such a great event. Thank you so much. Without further ado, I want to let you know one thing. We're passing out the surveys to you now during the event. And for those of you who put your survey in the basket, we have three major gifts. We're going to pull out names, and you can win some pretty hot gifts that came right from the mayor's closet. All right? All right. Mayor, you're on.
Good morning, everyone.
Testing one. Thank you for coming out on this gorgeous morning. I want to get started by bringing up, our assistant principal of the high school, Michael Kitch. Where are you, Mr. Kitch? There you are. Come on up. Give it up to our Michael Kitch, assistant principal of Henry Middle School.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I am Michael Kitch. I am the proud assistant principal of Henry Legacy. I'm speaking on behalf of Principal Don Roy, who sends his regrets. He's attending to a family obligation. But I'd like to say we're happy to host the mayor, his cabinet, the city council, the Denver police, but most importantly, the community. You are the reason we do what we do. It's you and your kids. Although Henry is in phase out, our teachers and staff show up every day living the DPS value of students first. I'd like to share a story that happened this week briefly about students first. I had a young lady, she was a seventh grade student, and she was having problems with the teacher, and her parent called and wanted her switched out of the class. We've been doing our best to switch the culture, make sure that kids have a healthy environment, and we went through our process. And at the end of the process, the seventh grade girl's like, I don't want to switch out of my class. I want to be in this class. I feel comfortable here. I like this teacher. I want to be part of this. So she went back to her mom and was like, I don't want to move. So I talked to the young lady and I said, what's the difference between sixth grade and seventh grade? Is it better or is it getting worse? What's up? I mean, you're who we're here for. And the young lady said, it's so much better. You guys are listening to us. You're trying to solve problems for us. You're here for us. And that said, you could get no better compliment, especially in the situation that we're in with phase out, is that every day we're showing up trying to make things better for our kids. Our main emphasis is to make sure that we're creating rich experiences to build 21st century skills and create healthy attitudes in our kids. It is our ultimate goal to be prepared. It's our ultimate goal to prepare every single one of our students for success in college and their career. So, without further ado, I'd like to pass the mic over to Councilman Kevin Flynn. There he is.
Thank you, Mike. Is this thing on? Okay, thank you. Welcome to Southwest Denver. I know we have a lot of visitors here from the mayor's staff, from city agencies, but if you live here, raise your hand. Welcome, Southwest Denver. A lot of people, when we're downtown, they'll say, I'm going down to Southwest Denver, and I like to correct them. You're coming up to Southwest Denver. Some of the new folks on the council, we've adopted little slogans, as the mayor's probably heard endlessly. Councilman Cashman over in District 6 says, District 6, the heart of Southwest Denver. He sounds like an FM radio guy, almost. And I always say, Council District 2 is the highest district in the city. I have to correct that and say highest point in the city and county of Denver. We have the highest point, we have the highest average elevation, so you come up to Southwest Denver. But you know what? Southwest Denver is still part of Denver. And as everyone knows, the city is going through some tremendous growth, some tremendous change. And we'd like to see some of that love down here, I think. First of all, I have not yet seen, but I know they will be here, council persons at large, Debbie Ortega and Robin Kanish. Debbie is in the back, and Councilwoman Kanish is on her way. Are there any other elected officials here? I just want to recognize them. I also want to take a moment and welcome you, not just to Southwest Denver, but to Bear Valley. You are in Bear Valley. My good friend, when I worked at the Rocky Mountain News, Gene Amel, was one of your residents down here in Bear Valley. I think of him a lot. But I also want to point out, I think I see Richard and Veronica Size. Richard is president of Bear Valley Improvement Association. He will have a table in the open house. And we're also, is Harvey Park here? Is Soshi Gaitan here? We have some Harvey Park residents here. Kat Alwin. So Harvey Park is in the house. Is Rob Collins from Pinecrest here, our RNO president? I would make it a goal this year. I want to organize 3 new neighborhood organizations. If you live in a neighborhood in Council District 2 and you are not yet, there's one who wants to join. If you are not in a registered neighborhood organization, come see me at our table in the open house. We will tell you how to get registered and get involved, okay? Finally, I want to, it's my job to introduce the mayor and to bring him up here, but I want to say a few things about when I first came into office. One of my goals, if you saw anything during the last election, one of my goals was to increase our public safety down here. And I want to tell you that it has been a pleasure to work with this mayor and with this police chief, Robert White, and with Commander Fleece to increase the personnel complement of the Denver Police Department. When I moved to Denver 36 years ago, we had about 1,420 officers, and we had about 460,000 population. Today, we have about 670,000 residents in the city and county of Denver, and a year and a half ago, we still had about 1,420 officers. So one of my primary goals has been to increase and to maintain the hiring that that Mayor Hancock began after the 2012 referendum. We were ramping up, but I wanted us to continue that. Working with Chief White, thank you very much. Police District 4 is no longer the longest response time in the city. I won't say who is. But we have reduced response times by a good 20% already in the last 2 years. And that is due to hiring additional officers last year, and in our budget this year, we have another 100 hires and increased the authorized strength, I believe, by 48 in this year's budget. So we're going to continue that at least through 2019. So, as people who follow the council know that I'm kind of a history buff, I always throw in sort of a little trivia point during our debates. Some of them are even true. This one is true, that Mayor Hancock made history in a way I don't know if he was aware of, but when he was elected, I mentioned to him, never in the history of Denver had a sitting city council member ever been elected mayor. I know Bob Kreider lived right outside here, and Bob ran, and he came close, but he never got on, he didn't win that either. Mayor Hancock is the first member of the Denver City Council ever to be elected mayor. But more importantly for Southwest Denver, Mayor Hancock represented District 11, which is far northeast Denver. And I believe that there are a lot of similarities between the issues that northeast Denver faced when he was on council and what Southwest Denver faces now that I'm on council. And I believe that gives us a good connection to continue to talk about economic development, about public safety, and about improving our quality of life. So with that, I would like to welcome up to Southwest Denver, Mayor Michael Hancock.
Thank you so much. Southwest Denver. Southwest Denver is such a pleasure to be here. And I'm going to ask you, if you will, this is where you clap more than you have ever in your life. Because we're going to thank a lot of people. But I want to celebrate your councilman, who is just a tremendous. By the way, it's very hard to have a former reporter on the city council. He remembers everything. Yeah. Every detail, on the record. He has all the details, and he knows all the questions. But thank your councilman. He's a tremendous representative for your area. Councilman Flynn. Again, we want to thank Michael Kitch, the assistant principal of this wonderful school here. Thank you again for allowing us into this great facility. And I want to celebrate the Eagle Harmony Vocal Ensemble one more time. Our young people are tremendous. And if I may, I've got to celebrate someone who came up and said hi to me just a moment ago. She was absolutely one of my favorite people in this entire city. And she and I served for 8 years together on city council. She was your representative for 12 years. But I want to celebrate the former city councilwoman of this area, Jeannie Fotz. It's somewhere in the house. There she is. That's my girl there. Councilman Flynn, another bit of trivia. Councilwoman Fotz and I sponsored our first pieces of ordinance, our city law together. And she and I, because our districts were so similar in terms of geographic topography and challenges, she and I worked together to pass our first bill together. And that was back in 2003. And it was great serving with you, Jeannie, and you're just a tremendous citizen for Denver. I want to welcome you all here. This is a tremendous opportunity that we started in 2012, where we bring the entire cabinet and basically almost every representatives from every agency in the city of Denver to a neighborhood for a few hours on a Saturday. We do it quarterly. And as I was thinking, as I was driving down here this morning, I was thinking and saying, you know what? These have become tremendous moments in my life as mayor of the city where we've had protesters come in. We've had wonderful talent of young people or groups of young people come up and demonstrate their talents. We've had great discussions occur here. We've had an opportunity to talk about some transformative moments in the life of our city right here in these cabinet in community meetings. And I just want to thank you for being here because they're a tremendous opportunity for all of us. And I know the city employees, the cabinet, staff, and other city employees appreciate the opportunity to come face-to-face. There aren't very many cities that on a Saturday you get to come face-to-face with your mayor, with your director of parks and recreation, your city attorney, your police chief, your fire chief, your sheriff, whoever you want, director of human services, are all here today to answer your questions and to have one-on-one conversations with you. So would you join me in thanking all the public servants who have showed up this morning? I understand not only do we have council members at large, but our clerk and recorder, Deborah Johnson, is here as well. Did I see Deborah somewhere? There she is. Thank you. And the last group I'm going to acknowledge before we bring up our first group, our public safety department is one of the best in the country. And the department is led by our director of safety, Stephanie O'Malley. And it includes our police chief, Robert White, our fire chief, Eric Tate, and our sheriff, Patrick Furman, the men and women who put on that uniform every day to serve and protect. I must also not forget our paramedics who are on the scene making sure that we're one of the best trauma response cities in the country. I'm going to ask our members of the Public Safety Department to stand up, and let's celebrate them today and thank them very much for their service to the people of this city. Thank you. I want to thank all the city employees and everyone who helped put this on. We have our Channel 8 here, our facilities crew that shows up early to set it up, our HR, our community, Human Rights and Community Partnership Group. Everybody makes this event possible so that we can have a great dialogue and we can bring government to the people of Denver. Listen, one of my favorite events or segments of Cabinet Community is where we get to bring up some of our most precious residents of Denver. We have a great animal shelter in Denver. And I believe it's right on the edge of this district, right? But every Cabinet Community, I feature a few or a couple of our animals. You heard one of them. He's a little loud and rambunctious. I'm going to ask Josh to come on up here. Sergeant, come up here and tell everyone about the animals you have here for adoption today and if how they may contact you. Like what I tell you. I'll take him. Who is this?
This is Eva.
Eva? So, hold on.
You start talking and Eva and I are going to have a conversation.
All right. So the mayor's holding Eva. This dog is a four-month-old bull terrier mix. Can you hear me? No?
Yeah, directly into the mic.
All right. There we go. So this is Eva. She's a four-month-old bull terrier mix that's available for adoption at the shelter. And then we have Winston over here in the background. He's a Westie that's also available for adoption. And we're located down at the Denver Animal Shelter over near Alameda and Santa Fe, 1241 West Bayard Avenue.
Okay, good deal.
Yeah.
This is our animal shelter, and we're very proud of them. And Eva is just rambunctious. She wants to be. Let's see the terrier. Are we live here? I think we have a battery problem. Testing. All right, they're ready for adoption if you want to take them. If not, we have other animals, I'm sure, cats. Whoa. We're going to have a debate here if we don't clear this. Thank you all very much. We'll see you afterwards. So today, I understand. Here's how this works. And Councilman Flynn, I think this is the second time we've been in Southwest Denver for Cabinet Community. Today, we're going to have some very brief comments from three sections of the city. And then we will release into the gymnasium, where all of us city agencies will post up at our tables and give you a chance to have one-on-one conversations. I want you just to remember three things from me this morning with regards to our priorities in the city of Denver for 2017. We enter this year as the fastest growing region in the country. In the Metro Denver region, population-wise, we are growing by 4,500 new people per month. The city of Denver represents 1,000 new people per month. So I want you to let that sink in for a moment. There is nothing anyone's intentionally doing to drive that growth. Denver and cities like Seattle, Dallas, have simply become the place where our millennials and, interestingly enough, baby boomers have decided to move. And so the good news is that people have discovered Denver. The bad news is people have discovered Denver. So we have some challenges. Of course, it has created pressure on our housing market. And so last year you saw us move to create a housing fund that will allow us to partner with developers and organizations like Denver Housing Authority and other stakeholders to begin the process of really trying to create new opportunities around affordable housing. The second area where we're really going to see some focus this year, because we have called 2017 the year of mobility in Denver. Our street grid is what it is. It's not like we're going to be able to add more streets in Denver. And so we have to strategically think about how we utilize our streets more with more variety, new opportunities. They become more multimodal. So in 2017, we'll be coming back to the voters of Denver, starting with our bond, to make an investment in mobility and our transportation infrastructure. And so we will be doing that in 2017. You'll hear more about that this spring and summer as we complete our plans and our strategies so we can have a good discussion about how we try to ease the congestion that we are seeing growing in Denver. And then finally, there are forecasts abound in terms of the health of our economy. Today, Denver's doing pretty well. We have been able to restore our fund balance or our savings account. Councilwoman Fox, you'll be very proud. At times, we've been at or over 20%, but since 2012, we've not dipped below 15% in our fund balance. And that's thanks to you, the people of Denver, who have made, that's not a, I think it's your court. That's thanks to you, the people of Denver, who've made sacrifices and made some very tough decisions on how we can continue to finance city government. And our unemployment rate is only, is an astounding, I shouldn't say only, but an astounding 2.6% today. 70,000 jobs have come to this city in the last 5.5 years. And so the city is doing well, but this is not the time for us to let up. And so the third priority area, first housing, mobility, will continue to be to continue to attract employment opportunities to the city of Denver. We still have segments that are struggling or challenged with access to jobs. And so we have to take a comprehensive systemic approach to help create those opportunities or help the folks come in contact with those employment opportunities here in the city of Denver. So we're going to stay focused on attracting those global opportunities to our city and make sure our residents are prepared to take advantage. So with that, the three areas you're going to hear today in terms of presentations, we know there's a lot of conversation with regards to the city of Denver and our positions around immigration. And so I'm going to ask the city attorney, Kristen Bronson, to come up in just a moment and talk about what we're doing in the legal matters around immigration. We're also going to hear from our safety department. Of course, Chief Whiting, your commander, Commander Fleece, is going to come up and talk about this area and with regards to the safety elements. And then we have a new employee who has moved here from, he's one of those folks who have created a population growth in Denver. But we created, with our focus on housing, we created a new office called the Office of Hope, Housing Opportunities for People Everywhere. And we attracted a gentleman, a tremendous leader in the housing industry by the name of Eric Sullivan. To Denver. He's going to talk about what this office is going to do, what the role of this office is around the areas of housing, along the spectrum from homelessness to housing. So with that, let's get started with our presentation so we can adjourn to the gym as quickly as possible. We're going to start with you, Kristen. Well, you all welcome our city attorney, Kristen Bronson.
Good morning, everyone. So I've been given an easy task this morning. I've been asked to address the city's approach to recent developments in the immigration enforcement area. First, let me say that it is a rapidly changing environment, and so I want to talk for just a minute about who we've been working with and some of the legwork we've been doing it before I get into the approach. We at the city, including DPD and the sheriff's office, have been working very hard to keep abreast of the many changes that are coming down at the federal level. We're trying to analyze the impact it's going to have on our local communities as well as our local law enforcement. We're working very closely with the other public law offices at the state and the federal level, that being our Denver District Attorney's Office, the governor's legal team, our acting U.S. attorney. And we are working with our county courts, trying to monitor what's happening in our courtrooms and courthouses. We're also keeping track of the federal lawsuits that have been filed across the country in response to some of the new administration's initiatives and trying to track those to determine what implications they may have for Denver. We've convened a legal working group of law professors, immigration law experts, former city attorneys, state attorneys, private practitioners to support our efforts, but to also help us analyze changes as they are announced at the federal level. Finally, we're working with other cities. I'm working with my counterpart city attorneys across the country. The mayor's been doing an awful lot of work with other mayors across the country to discuss strategies and practice, look at best practices, to look at the rights and responsibilities of cities like Denver, to evaluate and consider appropriate policy changes. What is our challenge? Our challenge is to protect the safety of this community while safeguarding the civil rights and the rule of law. One thing we know for certain is that the city relies on its local public safety officials to keep the community safe. Local law enforcement, and we've got Chief White and Sheriff Furman are both here, they have to develop a relationship of trust within our communities, particularly our more vulnerable communities, because many times they are the victims of crime. They are the witnesses to crime. Our police officers work every day to maintain that trust relationship. Our victims need to know it's safe to report crime. Our witnesses need to know that they are safe in helping police officers solve crime and prosecutors in building a case to enforce our laws. Asking our local law enforcement to enforce federal immigration laws undermines that trust. And we're not just hearing this in Denver, we're hearing this in cities across the country. Denver residents have to know that their officers' number one priority is their safety and security. This is a concern that's shared by the prosecution team in my office, but we're also working closely with Beth McCann, our new district attorney. Her office also has concerns in this area. If there is a gang-related violence, if there is a case involving human trafficking, we need to have witnesses who are willing to testify and come forward and help us build our case as prosecutors. Since the executive orders issued on January 25th, I'm sorry to say that we have had 4 undocumented victims of domestic violence who have called us, our office, and said they were too afraid to testify. They weren't willing to pursue the case any further because they were afraid of deportation. That is a great concern to us. We've had to dismiss those cases because we don't have witnesses to support the charges. And what happens, the perpetrators of these violent offenses are not feeling the consequences of their acts. This is especially disheartening to us because in 2016, we had our highest rate of domestic violence homicides in Denver ever. So we're very concerned about it. Now, this does not mean that the city should or will interfere with the federal government's immigration enforcement efforts. We will not shield violent and dangerous criminals. We don't want them on our streets, and we are not going to shield them from deportation. We can't stand between ICE and individuals that ICE has targeted for deportation, but we also don't have to do their job for them. Federal courts have made it crystal clear. It is unconstitutional for Denver to hold individuals in our jails for 1 minute longer than their state or local charges allow. We do honor federal criminal warrants, and we'll continue to do so, and those are always available to ICE. But our relationship with the federal immigration officers is important. We need to maintain effective lines of communication to ensure that dangerous and violent criminals are not on our streets. We have a job to do, and so do the federal law, immigration enforcement officers. We need to maintain a distinction between the federal role and the local role while keeping, again, those effective lines of communication open. In the coming weeks and months, we're going to continue to monitor the effort, the developments at the federal level. We're going to continue to work with our local law enforcement in keeping the streets safe, and all the while keeping Denver a welcoming and inclusive city. I want to let folks know that we do have some pro bono lawyers from the American Immigration Lawyers Association here today. They're going to have a table outside here in the hallways, so please try to find them if you have an interest in speaking with them one-on-one. We also have the ACLU here. We'll have a table, and they'll be available as well. The city attorney's office has a table, and my colleague Marley Bardowski and I will be there and would welcome the opportunity to talk with you about these or any other issues. Thank you very much.
Good job. Thank you, City Attorney Kristen Bronson. Very important issue, and Kristen will be here as well at her table if there are any additional questions as we go forward. Let's move on to public safety, and I want to bring up our police chief, Robert White, and your commander, our commander of District 4, Mark Fleece.
Thank you, Mayor. Good morning. You know, wanted to be kind of piggybacking off of what the city attorney stated, one of the things that the men and women in our department have been asked a lot lately in light of our new president is about immigration. And I guess to simplify it, while it is challenging and there are certainly things that are changing, but there are two things that won't change. How we police prior to the president is the same way we're going to police since the president's been on board. That being said, we didn't do immigration work prior to President Trump, and we're not doing immigration work since President Trump. So I want to make sure that that's perfectly clear with everybody. Now, I'm going to let Commander Fleece kind of talk about some of the successes briefly and some of the challenges in District 4. But I do want to spend a moment talking about one of the other challenges that we've been facing lately. Our department has consistently been in the last 6 or 7 years, one of the safe major cities in the world, in the country. There are about 55 major cities. Major cities, normally a city of about 500,000 more residents or 1,000 more police officers. And we've been consistently in the top 10 safest cities in the world, in the country. But that's not our goal. Our goal is to be number one. And in an effort to get there, we decided that we needed to make some changes as it relates to how we police. We need to be more engaging with the community. We need to look at our policies and procedures. So over the course of the last couple of years, we've trying to transform from a traditional police department to a much more progressive police department in an effort to obtain that goal that I think this community is deserving of, and thus being the safest major city in America. With that being said, we've been in the process of looking at all of our policies. We have hundreds of policies. One of late that I think has been of great interest to many in our community is our use of force policy. So we've had three public meetings as it relates to the use of force policy where we've opened it up to the community. I personally attended those meetings along with many members of my staff, and there have been other meetings that we've had as it relates to that. But we've also created a Facebook where individuals can give us feedback. So we received all that information. We're now in the process of looking at all the information we received from the venues that we've had where we've asked community to give us input. And we're going to sit down with someone from the union, someone from the city attorney's office, someone from the monitor's office, and a handful of citizens in our community. Look at those policies and get their recommendation to help formulate a final policy as it relates to use of force. So for those of you who have participated in that, I greatly appreciate it. Sometime in the next week or two, we'll be going to the city council members, asking them if they want to have a person from their council participate in the final formulation of the use of force policy. We're going to take all that information together. They're going to make recommendations to me. And with that, we will come up in the very near future with a final policy as it relates to use of force. So, again, I want to thank the community for all that you have done. I certainly want to thank Councilman Flynn He, like his predecessor, Jeannie Fox, have been a great supporter of the men and women of our police department, so we certainly appreciate that. And at this point, I'm going to pass it over to one of the best commanders in the city and county of Denver, Commander Mark Flintz. Mark Flintz.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. Is this working okay? Can you hear me? Okay. First of all, I want to say about a year and a half ago, Chief White called me into his office, and he let me know that he was moving me from my position at that time with the Investigative Support Division to District 4. And we've had several conversations since that day, and Chief White always reminds me that I wasn't the happiest guy in the room back then. I was comfortable with my job. I liked it. I knew it. It was my background with investigations. And I don't think I've ever told the chief this since then, but that move was probably one of the best in my entire career. Getting me back out in patrol division, working with the community really on a daily basis has been very rewarding for me. Working with the men and women out here, the investigators, the officers that you have working for you out in District 4, they're some of the most dedicated, committed officers and investigators that I've ever worked with in my entire career. So you're in good hands out here. As far as challenges, as far as some of the crime challenges that we have out here, motor vehicle theft is certainly at the top of the list. During any given week out in our police district alone, we have 20 cars, 20 vehicles that are stolen in any average week. And that's something that we've been working very hard on. During any typical winter, one out of every three cars that are stolen is a result of a puffer, somebody coming out and starting their car, warming it up, and then going back inside. Our data analysis unit recently did a study, and they looked at everybody that was arrested for motor vehicle theft over the last 3 years. And they found out that 32% of all those individuals actually live in our district. So those are some of the things that we're up against with motor vehicle theft. We do a lot of public outreach, public education, letting the citizens know which vehicles are being targeted the most, how they can protect themselves and keep their cars from being stolen. That's an ongoing type of a strategy for us, and we'll continue to do that. We give away a lot of clubs to the owners of those vehicles, Honda Accords, Jeep Liberties, Ford F-250 trucks, all those types of vehicles that are stolen on a consistent basis down here, the steering wheel clubs to prevent those thefts from happening. Another trend we've seen over the last 3 years, specifically license plate thefts, we categorize that as a theft from motor vehicle. We've seen increases on an annual basis of about 8%. We have about 1,200 crimes every year associated with theft from motor vehicles. Last year, we had about 600 of those were license plate thefts. So we have a booth, a table in the main auditorium out here. So when we get done with this presentation, please come visit us. We'll give you some tips and some things that you can do to help protect yourselves from those types of thefts going on. Street racing has been a big issue down here in District 4. Certainly Federal Boulevard and the things that happen, the cruising up on that particular street, the arterials on Sunday evenings. Over the last year, we've had three deaths directly associated with street racing. It's something we're very focused on. Going into 2017, we made some staffing changes that will allow us to provide more police officers that are dedicated specifically to that enforcement up on Federal on Sunday evenings. We're using the public nuisance abatement law when we can to target those individuals that are out there street racing. We're looking at technology that can identify the racers that participate in that kind of activity. I've been very active working with the businesses up on Federal Boulevard to try to get trespass laws enforced from people congregating in their parking lots that are unwanted. There are some parking lots that are actually targeted up there for speed demonstrations and racing. We're working with those owners to try to make those parking lots less conducive to that type of activity. Fireworks was a big issue last year. It kind of surprised me, actually, with the amount of interest in that. But it's interesting because of all the calls for service last year related to fireworks, District 4 had 40% of the entire city's calls for service. Last year, there was an increase in our district alone of 60% as far as calls for service from the previous year. We had 133 of them last year. So we're doing some things, working with city council offices to try to do some things this year that are more focused, you know, particularly in some of the specific neighborhoods down here in District 4. Those are some of the things that we're working on. The one thing that I want to say before I leave here is that we're a very data-driven police department. And, you know, with our limited amount of resources, it's important for us to know where the crime's happening so we can direct our officers into the proper locations during the days and times that those activities are happening. We did that last year. In fact, one of the major successes we had last year in our district is we had a substantial increase of street robberies from 2014 to 15. So last year, we really looked at the data and was able to pinpoint where most of that activity was happening and when it was happening, the days of the week, the most prominent times. We actually did a lot of proactive work directing our police officers into that particular area. The success of that last year is we dropped district-wide 20% in a decrease in street robberies. In that particular zone, we had a decrease of 46%. So that does work for us. So that's all I have. Thank you. Please visit us in the auditorium afterwards, and we'll give you a little bit more information as far as crime prevention goes.
Thank you, Commander. Chief White, Commander Fleece, thank you so much. Very thorough presentation. Thank you both so very much. And now we have, hold on, I was told to look at my cell phone and see if there's a message apparently that I have that I'm supposed to share with you all. Let's see what it is. It's not on here. You must say, yeah, thank you. Yeah, not driving, just facilitating. I think you may have sent it to the wrong phone. This is my personal phone. Okay, let's keep moving. We're almost there, and we're going to break in just a moment. But our last presentation is the newest member of a resident of our city, our Director of Housing and Opportunity with People Everywhere, Office of Housing and Opportunity for People Everywhere, Eric Sullivan.
Thank you, Mayor.
Hello, is this on?
All right, thank you, Mayor. Thank you for this opportunity. I wanted to just talk a little bit about the Office of Hope. As the Mayor had mentioned at the outset of his comments, there are 1,000 new residents coming to Denver each month, including myself. So that creates a tremendous amount of pressure as well as opportunity on our housing stock and expanding that housing stock and expanding that affordability as well as preservation of that housing stock. You know, it's the charge of the Office of Hope. How do we pull together and harness the resources of the city, leveraging those resources with our partners and our stakeholders across the city in order to expand that preservation and affordability of housing stock in every neighborhood. So that way the prosperity of Denver can be shared in every community and in every neighborhood. So part of my work is coordinating across our various departments and initiatives and bringing them together to say how we more strategically invest our resources. And how do we leverage that work and the leadership that we have both on council with Councilman Flynn, Councilwoman Kenich, who's been a true champion of housing affordability, and Councilwoman Ortega, who's really worked hard to address these issues. So over the next couple of months, the Hope Office is gonna be working on some short-term items that we can deliver on across the city, some of that low-hanging fruit to bring some of this work around housing affordability and preservation to action. And two, beginning to engage the public more comprehensively around these issues so that we can hear from all the neighborhoods. And one example of that will be the Mayor's Housing Summit coming up in May as we begin to articulate what is a collective vision, a vision that expresses the consensus throughout the city as to how we share in this prosperity and move all of our neighborhoods forward together. So I hope you come back and talk to me over at the Hope Table, and thanks for the opportunity.
Wonderful. So the people of Denver, through City Council action, are investing, starting this year, $15 million a year in affordable housing. And it is important that we maximize every cent, account for every cent, and make every cent count in our efforts. And that's why Eric is here, to make sure we're coordinating and we're talking. So thank you, Eric. I was remiss in not mentioning the fact, as we talk about transportation and mobility, that the city of Denver right now is in the midst of a deep strategic planning process with regard to transportation and mobility. And the Denver Right effort that is helping us to, that will certainly serve as a blueprint for our city and development and how we grow and where we grow, is taking place. And we've asked residents to weigh in. Denver Right is here today, and they've asked if you want to share your thoughts, to stop by their table and make sure that you share your thoughts with regards to how we plan the city for generations that are coming behind us, but also as we try to improve and increase our quality of life, our great quality of life in this great city of ours. So thank you all. Will you thank all of our presenters today? Thanks again, Chief. Mark, thank you. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to ask the residents to stay in their seat. I'm going to dismiss all of our city employees and agency leaders at this moment. They're always so loud when they do this. At your seat this morning or when you walked in. You should have received a survey. And while the city employees are going to take their seat, we ask if you would fill out that survey, hold it up when you're done, and we'll have city staff come and grab them from you. In just a moment, we're going to dismiss you to the gymnasium. And again, you'll have a chance to meet with city staff and agency leads and stakeholder partners one-on-one. But we ask if you would fill out that survey, wave it when you're done, we'll collect it, and then you can go and go to the table. Oh, and then there's some prizes. So if you want to stick around, I'll turn it over to Sean. Thank you again for being here. I'm going to go to my table.
Thank you, Mayor. Let's give him a hand, praise. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Councilman. Thank you.